I use quantum simulations to mimic processes that occur around black holes or in the early universe. And we do this through so-called analogue simulations.
You're building black holes and simulating the early universe in your lab?
Exactly.
And can you show me what's going on?
Happy to show you.
This experiment here is where we set up effects that occur around black holes by looking at the wave-vortex interaction in this open channel flow.
We have a wave generator in the corner, and then this allows us to pass waves that play with the vortex. And then we have a projector that projects a blue random pattern. And this dye reacts, so then under blue light, it appears green. Up above, we have two cameras that are looking at this pattern and reconstructs what's happening on the surface. Using that, we can see what's happened. Have they gained energy, perhaps taking energy from this vortex flow or any effects like this?
So we have a quantum system where the quantum properties are provided by, in this case, the quantum fluid. And what we then do, we generate this effective gravitational field through a fluid flow. In our case, we look at these interface waves that you experience in the bathtub or in the kitchen sink, looking at the ripples on this quantum liquid. And we are setting up vortex flows. And the waves interact with this vortex. And for the waves, it looks like this vortex manifests itself in the with the same behavior as light experiences around black holes.
We can recreate super radiance. Super radiance is just an effect where if you pass a wave and it interacts with a black hole that's rotating, it can steal some of that rotational energy, that angular momentum. And in fact, it can cause the black hole to slow down a bit. You can see they start in a sort of a straight line, and then when they play, they interact with the vortex, their path gets deformed, and we get a mixture of what are called co-rotating and counter-rotating waves.
So these waves are related to the paths photons take as they swirl into a black hole.
Exactly. And because these waves, they're sort of acting like light, we can perform these super radiant experiments, and we can see exactly how light and waves really play with a black hole.
Why do you need to study these kind of effects in a system like this? Why can't you do this using, say, theoretical equations or by using telescopes to observe black holes?
When you solve something on a computer, or even if you solve it analytically, you don't think about how would you actually extract it from a physical system. So what we learn here is about the complication of measuring this, although you're really the master of this universe here. This is your toy universe where you can control the flow, where you have detection methods, where everywhere around a black hole you can read out this information, and yet it is really hard. Because we have these ideas which are abstract concepts. We think a black hole can super radiantly scatter our fields. But this is just an hypothesis, and there's some trivialized calculation that supports it. And when you try to set up an experiment, you have to push the boundaries of your understanding. And then you need to really think, okay, how can I really be sure? How can I measure that? And every time when we do this, I mean, at least I realize I know nothing about this.
By working with physical systems, you get a better understanding, a better intuition, but also you have to sharpen your mathematical toolboxes, because now they need to include everything that there is in these experiments. And often then you discover new facets or aspects of it that go back and drive theoretical research. So it's sort of a virtuous cycle between theory and experiment, and in tandem, you drive the research and the understanding forward.